what is the purpose of angels entering into your life prophetically is a very purposeful thing, because what happens to the brain is the brain starts to take on a different literature and a different knowledge. One of the major impartations of an angel's presence in your life is the knowledge switch. So if you look at the life of Elijah, while Elijah is in that place of hearing God, he has also the angelic speaking to him, because angels work alongside of the Holy Ghost to get messages to you. So angels don't replace the Holy Spirit of God. What angels do is they work alongside of the Holy Spirit of God. So there's some messages that the angels, their job is to get that message to you, rather than the Spirit of God doing it directly and solo. So you think about it, the Holy Spirit could speak to Mary Magdalene, or Mary, the mother of Jesus, to tell her that she's going to have a child, but instead Gabriel is entrusted with that word. The angels that speak throughout a person's walk with God, they have a job also to prophetically talk to you. Their job is to give you an upgrade in your knowledge, an upgrade in your intelligence, and they also are helpers so that you don't miss God. Elijah is in one place, 1 minute. He has the mindset that he's going to keep on calling down fire from heaven. What happens with the angel? The angel tells him at one point, when the captain, his 50 comes, to not do that again, but to go down with him. But that captain had a different approach to Elijah. The other captains, they came forcefully. They came with aggression. They came with prestige. And they came with a type of demeanor like, you better listen to us because we are officers. We are officials. We come to arrest you. You better do what we say, or else we're going to take force. And Elijah felt threatened by them. He called down fire, and fire backed him. Every prophet of God that's knit with Jesus has an authority over a certain level of fire. Depending on that prophet, if they are really in tune with Jesus, they are really in tune with the Spirit of Jesus, and they are real humble before him, their fire is higher. If a prophet makes a lot of mistakes, they're still manly, they're still carnal. If they do have fire, it's very small. The Word of God actually talked about the prophet that speaks from they speak like prematurely, and the thing doesn't come to pass. They say, don't respect them. I mean that their fire, if they do have fire, is small. It can't burn you, none. It's just a little heat. But the fire expands based upon humility. So when the Word of God talked in Numbers, it said Moses was the most humblest man in all the earth. So his fire was high. When Moses was on the earth, he was the greatest person on the earth. You ever thought about that? Pharaoh was esteemed to be so great according to the natural jurisdiction. But according to real authority, Moses was the greatest man on the earth. That's how God intended when he made Adam. Adam was the greatest being on the earth. And what Adam was carrying was a high level of fire. That's why when he lost his fire, fire kept him out of the Garden of Eden. Fire could not remain in the Garden of Eden because, fire could not it had to be fire that blocked him out, because he had fire in his authority. So God used the greater fire to go back and forth to let him know, you can't come back here. Now, saints, I want you to hear this. The Garden of Eden is over there by Africa. I want you to hear this. I want you to hear this. And that's why God loves Africa. God raises up men of God and prophets and apostles from Africa, because the Garden of Eden was neighboring to Africa. But the Garden of Eden was not Africa. And that's where a lot of people go wrong. It wasn't Africa. It was near Africa. And that's why you see a lot of stuff that go on, whether it be Sierra Leone and those wars that go on in the Congo and all over those places. Why is there so much activity? Because these were the neighboring cities or the neighboring countries and places that the tree of the knowledge of good and evil was passed on to them. Syria, Iran, Iraq. As you can see, they're enemies of Israel. They're enemies of God, because their continent was the neighboring city of the Garden of Eden. It was a neighboring country, a neighboring continent next to the Garden of Eden. The Garden of Eden is now occupied by no man right now. It was blocked off. Let me show you something that you probably never thought about before. Okay, so Adam was a sinner. He gets driven out of the garden, and God blocks the garden from a sinner. Now, when man come into the earth, what are they coming into the earth underneath the bracket of? A sinner. So why would they be living in the place that God blocked off? But saints, I want you to understand why there's so much grace in Africa, because it was near to the Garden of Eden. Why do you think that there is gold in Africa? There's literally gold. There's gold in the grounds of Africa. There's gold in the grounds of Ethiopia. And then did you know that the Garden of Eden was next to Egypt? That's why Egypt had the gold. So when God sent Moses, he sent Moses to go speak to who? Egypt. To tell them, let my people go. But they brought them out. He brought them out with their silver and their gold, because Havilah was the place of gold in Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2, Havilah was near to Africa. Havilah was near to Egypt. Havilah was near to Ethiopia. Havilah was near to Iran and Iraq and Afghanistan. That's why you see that these nations walk in such levels of wickedness, because the tree of the knowledge of good and evil passed to them firstly. Yes, it has spread abroad to Chicago. Yes, it has spread abroad to Missouri. Yes, it has spread abroad to Alabama and Mississippi and Louisiana and New York and New Jersey and Florida and Georgia and Texas. Yes, it has spread abroad, but and yes, it spread abroad to Australia, but it spread abroad firstly to Egypt, to Africa, to Ethiopia, to Assyria, to Iraq, to Iran, to Afghanistan, to Turkey. Are you hearing me? So the Garden of Eden was blocked off by cherubims. So watch this here. If all man come underneath the bracket of a sinner, why would God let them enter the land of the Garden of Eden when he blocked it off for that very purpose? Sin. So a lot of times people be like, Where's the Garden of Eden on the earth? Some say, well, it's in Africa. Some say, no, it's over here by this place. No, it's over here. The Garden of Eden is not on the map. There are places that have been wiped off the map. Sodom and Gomorrah was on the map before Abram. But after Abram, Sodom and Gomorrah was wiped off of the map. Sodom and Gomorrah don't exist on the map. God burnt that place with fire. So saints, when we dealing with that realm of the presence of God on a prophet of God, that fire is evident. It is a realm that prophet carries depending on his humility. Why is the fire so important? Because it takes a humble prophet to destroy certain strong man demons that are in your life culturistically. Did you know that the first thing that you encounter when you come to the earth is the culture? Everybody has a culture. If you're black, you have a culture. If you're white, you have a culture. If you're Hispanic, you Mexican, you have a culture. If you are Belize, whatever, you Dominican Republic, you have a culture. Everybody has a culture. So your culture is a foundation of beliefs, persuasions, lifestyles, behaviors, reactions, appetites. So a Mexican child don't eat the same thing as a child from Europe. An African child don't eat the same thing as a child from Philippines. Everybody, they take in, and the Chinese, they don't eat the same thing as the person from Turkey. Their culture is determining their lifestyle when they first come into the earth. So a lot of you all, I want you to catch this. When you're a little child, you become big in weight because that's the culture that you was born into. When you was a little child, you become real skinny, you real tiny, you real bony because that's the culture that you was born into. When you grow up, you may have somebody saying you can't go to parties. That's the culture that you grow up to. But when you grow up, you may have somebody saying you can have fun, but don't do nothing crazy. Here's a condom. Here's this. Because that's the culture you grow up to. Everybody is grown up into a different culture. Now, here's the crazy thing about culture. Culture is divine to a certain degree, but the majority of cultures have been manipulated by the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. So the most of the things that you're hearing from is fallen angels, is not the angels of God. The things that you hear are not being created by the culture of the angels. Did you know that angels have a culture? So Michael trained his angels to move in the culture of Michael. Gabriel had his angels move in the culture of Gabriel. So what is Gabriel? What is the culture of Gabriel, the prophetic? So prophecy is their culture. When something is happening in the plan of God, Gabriel is coming with the prophecy of it to talk to you about it. So Gabriel, his culture is prophecy. Michael, he doesn't have one culture alone. He's been entrusted with different cultures. Because when God called him to fight Lucifer, that was something he had never did before. And he passed. Michael is one of the angels that, no, he's an archangel that has promotion and graduation in his repertoire, in his history, in his resume. So if Michael shows you his resume, he'll show you God promoted me on this day in the heavenlies because I did this well. Michael received promotion because of overcoming Satan. You receive promotion by overcoming Satan. Michael received his rank going higher because he overcame Satan. You receive promotion and graduation when you overcome Satan. Michael was respected to a higher degree and dimension because there was resistance with Lucifer's will against his will. And he still stuck with the will of God. You receive graduation and elevation when there is a resistance between Lucifer's will and you choose the will of God.